Alright guys, and welcome back. Today we're going to be looking at 10 random, rare hip-hop CDs from the collection. These are not necessarily the rarest albums I own, but just some I thought you guys might find interesting. Some of them were harder for me to track down. I think there's some really dope shit in here, so we're going to get right into it. Released in 2008, this is Ono's second collaboration with the record label Now Again, which is most notorious for being founded by Egon, who's been making headlines recently for refusing to return the notebooks of MF Doom to his family. This album finds Ono digging through the Now Again library and sampling everything from American soul, funk, and jazz to Iranian folk to remix Percy P's debut album, Perseverance, which itself was originally produced and again remixed by Ono's brother Madlib. Ono is such an underrated producer, and the production he laces Percy with on this project is absolutely incredible. Maybe not as cohesive as the original version, but still an incredibly interesting project in its own right. This was an album I'd been hunting for since it was first released, and I was lucky enough to snatch up a copy last year for $15. It was an absolute steal and one of my favorite pieces from the collection. So, I have a fairly comprehensive MF Doom collection, a lot of which you could probably consider to be rare, and I wondered, should I include the original Mad Villainy 2 remix box set, the Operation Doomsday lunchbox, or maybe even go with Victor Vaughn's sophomore release, Venomous Villains. And instead, I opted to go MF Doom adjacent with this debut solo LP from fellow MIC member, Gigan. Gigan is probably best known for his solo cut Crazy Worlds off MF Doom's 2003 release Take Me To Your Leader, released under the name King Ghidra. Other than that, he also popped up on the MIC debut album Escape From Monster Island, also released in 2003, and a few times on X-Ray's Monster Mixes Volume 1 and 2. As far as solo material goes though, this was it. His debut EP was released around the same time as Kong and Rodan's, and much like many of X-Ray's other Mindbender releases, it was completely handmade and sold hand-to-hand. This was the only place to find these Gigan songs though, which makes it an absolute grail for MIC collectors. I just happened to be contacted by somebody within that camp when I was writing for hip-hop blogs years ago, and they offered to sell me a copy of this, Kong, and Rodan's EPs, and sadly I only had enough for this one, but I still feel incredibly lucky to have this one fall into my lap. Hobo Junction was a group I discovered out of my love for Saphir's music, specifically his 1994 debut album, Boxcar Sessions. While digging for more music to consume, I randomly discovered that he was part of a collective with a bunch of other rappers I had never heard of, and I don't say that to be disrespectful. The biggest name here outside of Saphir himself is probably IQ, and none of these other artists I have ever heard from again outside of the Hobo Junction projects. The Cleaners is their 1999 album and the first project I properly heard from this group. The album itself isn't bad, especially if you're a fan of underground West Coast music, and while I don't think it's worth the money that's being asked for it now, usually going between about $40 and $80, I do think it's incredibly interesting and incredibly slept on, and I do have a question for all my West Coast heads out there. Did any of the guys from Hobo Junction go on to release anything worthwhile outside of this group? Let me know in the comments. Okay, so this is a unique one that I've never seen anybody else ever talk about. Released in 2008 alongside the standard edition of this album, the special edition features the same exact music with the only noticeable difference being the slip you see in front of the booklet. Released exclusively online through DJ Mug's website, I think this was limited to around 50 copies. The inside of the booklet tells you the exact number, which one you got, but I've never bothered to open mine since I already have the regular edition of the album. It was also included as a bundle with a keychain and a Planet Asia and DJ Mug's mixtape, which was surprisingly pressed on an actual CD and not a CDR. This is one of those obscure albums that would only be worth something to the hardcore collectors, especially since it contains all the same music, but personally I think it's an incredibly interesting variant on a classic album and one that I have never seen mentioned before. Does anybody else out there have this version of the album? Let me know. So like many of you, I'm sure, I saw the release of Ninth Wonder's 2007 LP, The Dream Merchant 2, and thought to myself, well, where the hell's the first one? I'd been a fan of Ninth Wonder since discovering Little Brother's music back on their debut album, The Listening, in 2003, but to say I followed his career with any sort of intensity would be a lie. I was a casual fan who enjoyed what I heard, but it wasn't until a few years later when I started to actively dig into the solo LB music I'd missed that I started to run across some of these gems. That being said, I'm still not exactly clear on where this album came from. Wikipedia tells me it was released in a bundle with an away team and a legacy album, but I can't confirm that. I do know it took me a little bit to digging to find this one, and it wasn't even overly expensive, I just never saw any copies go up for sale. But I am happy to have this one in the Ninth Wonder collection, but if anybody out there copped this when it originally came out, can you please give me the history behind it, because I am legitimately curious where this came from. The Grey Album was one of the most important mixtapes to ever be created, and while it was nowhere near the first album to take vocals from a rapper and mash them up with new music tied together conceptually by sampling one artist or genre of music as inspiration, The Grey Album was by far the biggest, putting Danger Mouse on the map and ushering in a whole new wave of blend tapes and remixes. This album finds Danger Mouse taking the acapellas from Jay-Z's 2003 retirement LP, The Black Album, and blending them over his own production built around samples from the Beatles' legendary The White Album. The results was a classic mixtape which pushed boundaries and just really thrusted Danger Mouse into the pop culture spotlight. Now obviously with an album built around Beatles samples, there was no real way to press this up and make money off of it. But where there's a will, there's a way, and sure enough, physical copies of this do exist. Listed as a promo album and sold by Danger Mouse himself, I'm not sure of the exact number printed up, but I do know there's plenty of bootlegs and repressings out there, which made tracking down an original version an absolute nightmare. But this is just one of those amazing albums where every time I look at it, I feel like I'm holding a piece of history, and it's definitely one of my favorite CDs in the collection. Featuring an absolutely incredible lineup with the likes of Pete Rock, Marco Polo, Grap Lova, and Raz G, The Lost I and I Project was a grail for 90s hip-hop fans worldwide. Produced mostly by Pete Rock and featuring some of his absolute best production, the fact that this album got shelved in the 90s is mind-boggling. It's widely considered a classic for a reason, and the fact that hip-hop fans everywhere could only obtain this music via bootlegs was a travesty. Thankfully, the album got a slight reworking and pressed up in 2003 as part of a double album. One disc was the I and I Project, the other one was the original Baby Pa album, both produced by Pete Rock. And at the time, this was the kind of release that hip-hop fans dreamed about. Classic lost albums getting official releases, two albums worth of unheard Pete Rock beats. It was definitely worth the price of admission. This is one that's definitely gotten more expensive with time, but personally I feel like it's honestly money well spent because these are two incredible albums that I think every hardcore hip-hop fan should own. Currency made some of my favorite modern music when he released Pilot Talks 1 and 2, and he immediately became an artist I started to follow, snatching up any and every CD I could come across. This was an odd one for me. I knew of this album when it was releasing, but I could not find anywhere selling it. There was nowhere I could stream it, and the more I dug into it and learned about it, the stranger it seemed. He was working with a singer-songwriter by the name of Sean O'Connell, who I'd never heard of, but also serves as the producer for the Currency portion of this album. And I say the Currency portion because a lot of this is, it also includes Sean, I don't know if it's his debut album, but it also includes his album, which is like weird 60s psych rock infused. It's interesting, but it's definitely not what the Currency fans were here for. But the Currency side of this album is absolutely incredible. He's rhyming over the same kind of 60s psych rock, but it really works, and it's a very interesting album and a very interesting direction to take his music. This one may not be super rare, but I know it's one that people don't really talk about, and I think a lot of people slept on it. But if you are a Currency fan, definitely go back and check this one out. So when I put this list together, my goal was to not include a bunch of old school albums that only got more expensive after the fact. Instead, I wanted to single out some albums that were rare and hard to find even at the time of release. But that being said, Big Daddy Kane's Veterans Day was always one of those rare old school albums that I not only missed out on, but I didn't even know about it until years after it was released. Kane's final solo album, which was released in 1998, isn't his best, but I also wouldn't say it's his worst. But it is definitely targeted at the hardcore Juice Crew fans. Commercially, I couldn't tell you how the album performed, but I do know by the time I started to actively collect, I just could not find this album anywhere. It was never one I saw in person, and most of my collection was put together by hand from years and years and years of digging, but this one just never showed up in any of the stores I went to. It's not a super rare album, you could probably get it for less than $30, but it makes its inclusion on the list for the fact that I dug for this album for years and could never find it. Obviously, I was a fan of Cool Keith's work with the Ultramagnetic MCs, which is what made me a fan of his oddball, surreal style of music. But it wasn't until his 1999 album, First Come, First Served as Dr. Doom, that I became a diehard fan and immediately went into his back catalog to dig up any and every album I had missed. Ultra was one that piqued my interest immediately. I thought the idea of Cool Keith teaming up with the ultra-hardcore Tim Dog seemed like a no-brainer, and at the same time, I just couldn't imagine what the album was going to sound like. Thankfully, it didn't take me too long to track this one down for a decent price, and I was even happier to find out that it's like a classic Cool Keith album. If you're a fan of Cool Keith, if you're a fan of Tim Dog, it's just a perfect project from both of them. Easily another lost Cool Keith classic. It might not be held in the same high regards as the Cenobites album, but this is easily one of Keith's best pieces of work, and I think one that a lot of people overlook, so definitely check this one out if you see it.